Good afternoon, everyone. And here again, we are with us today with another session of In School Synergy series. It is a session where we welcome our participants to reflect on the topic which we have discussed before. And we also try to reflect and discuss the feedback questions which many of the participants have shared during us in their feedback form. So now I request Zeba and Gomti to kindly begin and share their comments and reflection over the feedback question which we had in the last session. And then we will try to build more on this, and we will welcome you also to share your reflection, your question right now on this session. And if you have any live case studies or any learning from your classroom or any particular examples which you would like to share with us, or the challenges which you are facing, definitely we'd love to hear, because that's the point right now. We all are here today to discuss more and share from our own experiences, right? So yeah, please Gomti and Seva, please kindly go ahead.
Thank you, Shalini. Zeba, you can also unmute, and like we can, I think, do this like in an informal manner.
Yeah.
I think let's start with the first question that was shared with us. And I think this is also one of the biggest questions that a lot of mainstream teachers do have. The question was about the curriculum and how can you take this back to your setting by making sure that you are still able to sort of address all the units that you have in your textbook, given that you do have a lot of units you need to cover in one sort of in a lesser span of time. And definitely inquiry is a process that takes a lot more time. It is fruitful when it is when you have that enough time, you know, that you are giving to doing the inquiry process. So I think for us, one thing that Gateway does where we come from in terms of the curriculum is we do make our own curriculum for the middle school and lower school groups. The reason for this is our kids do have needs. Given that they have needs, our school works on trying to give them units and curriculum and design the curriculum in a way that is relevant. So it is relevant to what's happening around them now. The units, the topics that we do pick are relevant to the situation that the students are in right now. The curriculum also is designed on the basis of the student's strengths. So if it is not a skill that the student, or if it is not a skill that the student is even going to take back, or that group of students, say for example in language, say writing is in lower school is not a strength at all for any of the students, then in that unit, in that moment, we would have a unit on reading or listening and develop those skills that the students do have some sort of skills in, and then develop from there. Keeping that in mind, we would also look at the humanities, science, civic, or other units like that. So other social studies units. So we definitely do a lot of planning, a lot of, just thinking about the child before we can design the curriculum. We also look at trying to keep our curriculum as generalizable. Like I said, it has to be relevant. The skills, whatever the students are learning in that unit, in that curriculum, has to be generalizable, especially for our students, because they do need to be able to, they do need to be explicitly taught, and the instructions have to be explicit. And if the skills are not generalizable for our students, we do fail to see then independence in them. We do fail to see, you know, a lot of other skills that a mainstream student or a student who's a neurotypical student may not be things that you are looking for. Now, keeping this in mind, what Gateway does is Gateway looks at the IGCSE curriculum for the middle school and lower school students while we are designing our curriculum. So we do take, things from the IGCSE curriculum, content from the IGCSE curriculum, because a lot of our students, when they go to high school, they will be attempting the IGCSE board exam. We have two boards in high school. One is the IGCSE board and one is the NIOS board. So all our students, after they are done with, when they are in their last year of middle school, we sort of start having vision statements, think about their strengths, their skills, and then sort of guide them to take up a curriculum for the next year, for their high school. The IGCSE curriculum, we look at the students' critical thinking skills, their ability to sort of be able to analyze, to be able to interpret questions. Those skills are developed through incorporating units from the IGCSE curriculum in the lower and the high, middle school level. However, there are a lot of our students whose strengths is definitely not being able to comprehend. Comprehension may not be a strength. In analyzing may not be a strength. For students who come, whose strength may be, say, repetition, students whose strengths may be something like memorizing, we do recommend NIOS for those students, and they would probably do NIOS in their high school. However, keeping, I mean, we are also trying to now incorporate NIOS units in our middle and high or lower school curriculum to help them have that easier transition. That is our curriculum. Apart from that, while we are designing our curriculum, we are also looking at core standards, just like you would for, just like your curriculums would be designed. We are looking at core standards and sort of pulling from those. Again, we are keeping our students' grade levels at mind, which may look a little different from a mainstream school, given that our population is definitely, going to be addressed a little differently. I think now coming to how do you take what we are doing and pull that into your space, right? What Zeba and I were talking about was in the mainstream curriculum, we know that they are not really big ideas or units, but we have chapters. We have a subject and then we have chapters within the subject. Now, the textbook and the chapters in the textbook will be your space where you can pull from to have your goals, to put down your objectives, to think about the content that you're going to be teaching your children. So that would be your sort of space, your sort of starting point to design a curriculum. Having said, to design an inquiry project, having said that, one chapter would be really small, right? One chapter may address a very small part. Also, you have very limited time for addressing that one chapter. So a great idea in inquiry and at every point of time is collaboration, is integration. So it's look at your textbook, look at chapters that could be integrated, that could be taught together. Look at chapters across disciplines that can be taught together, and club that. Again, a lot of planning, a lot of collaboration, and a lot of work before the sort of year starts is what goes into this. So looking really thoroughly, going through your textbook, going through your units beforehand, going through your chapters beforehand, seeing what chapters can be taught together, what chapters can be clubbed together, are there units that can be worked together to make a bigger unit and therefore make it an inquiry unit, looking at in language, is there any unit in language, any reading, writing unit in language that I can club with what I'm doing here in my, say, science class? Is there any unit in maths that I can club with my science class? Are there any calculations, any chapters that they're learning in math that they can pull from, and those skills can be used in our class? So planning interdisciplinary teachers, planning by looking at your textbook and integrating units, I think is the biggest thing that you can do as a mainstream teacher to pull in inquiry into your class seamlessly, but also to make sure that you're staying within that time frame. Seba, is there anything you want to add? Please go ahead.
Just one thing to add to this is that realistically speaking, there's a chance that you're not going to get to do every unit or every chapter through this method of PBL. So inquiry process would be something you would aim one unit in the year, in the academic year, and kind of build on that. So like integrating chapters, different disciplines, combining chapters together will give you enough time of at least, if not 8 weeks, if at least 4 weeks or something to conduct an inquiry process. But please do not think that, okay, every chapter, every unit has to be done through the inquiry process. Even in our school, like in one academic year, we do 4 units, which are integrated. Out of those 4 units, we make sure at least one is an inquiry-based project and not all. So, yeah.
Yeah, I think thank you so much, Gomti. I think these Gomti and Zeba have tried to answer some of the questions, the queries which our participants asked in our feedback form. Like whatever the ideas they have discussed in the last session, it came mainly requires a lot of timing from the teacher side. At the same time, a lot of timing during the implementation when you're working with the children. So the first question which was there from the participant, like how is it possible for a teacher who has a short time and has to cover a lot of chapters, and I think what they suggested, we could do collaboration. So I would love to hear from the participant, anyone could talk on what if they have ever done any kind of collaboration with any other subject teachers to at least instill the idea of inquiry among students, or to bring the idea of inquiry in the class, any of the teachers. Kindly. Yes, Gaurav, I think I've seen you unmute yourself. Do you want to share something? Aruna, Gurvinder, Jaya, Mayur, Rashmi, Siksha, Yasmin, do you want to share anything about, through your experience?
Ma'am, I have not practiced anything right till now that can integrate the various subjects, so I don't have experience.
Means do you have any challenges like which you think that it's really difficult to bring the kind of initiatives which they have talked about in classroom?
You are talking about the integration of different subjects, then curriculum of and syllabus to be covered in particular month is already decided by the higher authorities. So how can they merge or how can they integrate? Until from the up-down initiative that is decided that or the curriculum is revised, then they can do something. Otherwise, if in 1 month, a social science teacher is teaching something else, and Hindi teacher is teaching something else, then how can they integrate? There will be a challenge.
Ma'am, I have a suggestion. I mean, perhaps what you can try is to talk with a Hindi teacher or a science teacher, and see if you want to work together on this. And maybe you can club the classes with them sort of co-teach it. And this, I am sure authorities would not be so against this kind of teaching as long as it is benefiting the students. And if you do it in the beginning of the semester or beginning of the academic year, such kind of exploration, you will have time and space to try out some things new without having the stress of finishing up for the examinations or preparing students for the examinations itself. So if you can just try out even once working with any other teacher, integrating these curriculum subjects, I think it would really help. But even if you do not have an experience, see, we have these implementation workshops, like the follow-up workshops is to help teachers also to think in terms of design. Let's suppose you want to think about some topic that you want to integrate with other subject teacher, or to think about how to design it in an integrated way. You can share your initial thoughts, and maybe we all can work towards helping you in developing that into a classroom-based design of integration of subjects.
I just wanted to add, like you shared, there are a few units that have been pre-designed and, asked of you to administer in that period of, say, the first term, right? I'm wondering, even within your own subject, given the units that you have been asked to sort of plan on, you can even look at those units and see if there's any, if there are any two chapters that you can work on together, if there are any maybe one or two chapters that can be addressed together. That also will allow you to make and maybe design an inquiry, because now you'll have more goals to address. You'll also be addressing two or three chapters in that one inquiry process. So you're building background knowledge for all those two or three units very seamlessly while you're doing that. So like Ruchi said, you definitely have to start the planning in the beginning of the academic year in order to be able to administer it in the academic year. But while you're doing that, maybe just given what you have, look at your units before you can. I understand integration might be with other disciplines may not, you know, be as easy. So you can maybe first look at your own chapters, see which chapters you can club, which chapters you can work on together. So you have more time in your hands to design that entire project and sort of implement it.
Jaya, do you want to share something with us?
Yeah, see, we are a small school in Chennai and we have been doing this. It's a CBSE school and we have started planning for our next year curriculum and we are integrating. We are taking in English, EVS, that is life skill, and Hindi and English.
Yeah, can you share some examples with us? Presently, there are a lot of participants with us who are there with CBSE course. So if you can share some examples, some case studies, so it will be very helpful.
Yeah, like especially if we take as well as in Tamil. And we are trying to see if we can link it to something with social studies, some issue, some chapter there. So then all the four things are integrated. So the children are doing the same thing in various periods. So the prior knowledge and the knowledge after that. So overall, I feel ki yes, that has been quite successful. Children are able to talk in different things, like on different topics and aspects of it in language as well as in social study. So we have started planning for next year from now and we are integrating from class one onwards. From class one, this time it's going to be languages as well as social study. That's life skill for them. So that is what we are doing. And some of the ideas I'm taking from you and taking them back to my school. And some of it, yes, we are also doing quite similar. The project that you people had done about energy and all that, yes, we have tried it in our school for class grade 7 and 8. Something similar even we have done, you know, where kids have got all this information about solar panels and electricity and all that. There we integrated maths and social study. So the topic was social study, but the math teacher also helped them, the computer teacher also helped them. Yeah, that's it.
Okay. Yeah, thank you so much, Jaya. I think it is something, an interesting point, and at the same time, very crucial point, because when we heard Zeba and Gopti, so Gurvinder is asking, can you share some more example of integration of maths and social science, Jaya? So what we can do, Jaya, if you can share, you can take few minutes and if you can just shape your experience in a much better way or some ideas, then we can share again.
Yeah. Yeah, I'll need some time.
Because please, you can have time. So meanwhile, can we, Aruna, I think you also wanted to share something.
May I?
Yes, please go ahead, yeah.
Okay, so I am not a teacher, but I'm a speech therapist with experience working in a school which follows the CBSE curriculum. And can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay.
Yes,
okay. And I was a school counselor, student counselor, and I also took life skill classes. Because I was offered the freedom to make my own, plan my own way of taking life skills, I took a lot of effort to integrate what the children were learning in other subjects into my life skill classes, and that there were many opportunities to take textbook learning and interpret it from the students' own life experiences. One thing that I would really like to talk more about is in 2018, we had very heavy rains in Kerala. I worked in Munnar. So there were floods and we had a lot of damage and loss of life and property. And when the children came back to school after a long break, we were given very, we were suggested that we first help the children deal with the, the terrible experiences that they had during this time. And it was very interesting to speak to the children and use their knowledge of what they have studied in geography and science to interpret the natural phenomenon that we saw in Kerala that time, when the, all the dams were opened up and water was everywhere, and how to interpret science with the damage that they saw on the ground. So it was good to see the children go back to their textbooks and understand how to come to damage that they had seen.
Yeah, I think that's a very crucial point, Gumti. I think when we were talking about last session, the inquiry and trying to build the pre-knowledge, and at the same time looking at the context, the students and the teacher as well, they are. So Aruna, that's really a great work which you did when you used the context at the present where you all were and trying to build in that context the topic which are there in the textbook. So Gumti, do you have any point to add?
The only difference between my experience and an inquiry-based approach would be that inquiry-based approach goes through those four steps that they were talking about: goals and plan, do, check, inquiry. Whereas this was, students have already finished learning something in a textbook, and then they have experienced something in their natural environment. And then they reflect back on their learning to understand their real-life experiences better. So it is more of introspection rather than inquiry-based approach. Would that be right?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I think one thing that, that you were able to do was give them skills that were generalizable, right? Because you came to them from the speech therapist perspective or from the life skill teacher perspective, where you could have maybe given them a template on how they would share their opinions. So you are building their skills of sharing opinions, introspecting, thinking about what has happened. These are all very, very generalizable skills. This is not just something that they would do for the thing that has happened now, for the natural calamity that happened now, but also for so many other areas in life, so many other aspects in life. It is definitely a skill that we want our kids to go out of school with, right? And you were able to, while you were teaching them those skills, while you were sort of building their opinion building and, building those skills of sharing, giving them that template of how they can share, what are the things I have to think of when I'm introspecting, how am I feeling, how do I share that? When you're sort of giving them that template, when you're teaching them that, you're teaching them that using something that they already know. So the content you pulled from was the content that they had already learned, right?
That's
right.
And
then you were allowing them to use the knowledge that they already had and then organize that in order to develop these new skills that you were teaching them of speech, of sharing, of building opinions. And that was really, I feel like, very fruitful, because now the children are only now developing your skills in your in their classroom. They are not developing, the knowledge of what does this look like, what is that. They already have that knowledge. So you use that to your advantage. You use that to the advantage of the students and help them sort of learn successfully in your class to build those skills that you were working on them with. And that's wonderful. So thank you for sharing that with us.
Thank you. Thank you.
Whatever I think the Aruna shared with us, being in the context and using that context to build that inquiry process. Anyone else have done the same thing? Rashmi, Yasmin, Mayur.
Hello, ma'am. Good afternoon.
Yes,
I haven't yet done such. I am a teacher, social science teacher. So I'm teaching sixth grade. Recently started teaching social science about 3 months back. And now today I had begun the chapter and I was really into that question, it is just like I got a question in the morning and now it is being answered sort of thing. This workshop is so useful for me and my doubt is cleared. I actually, because of the shortage of time, I was just thinking that how to complete these chapters, and they are all well integrated, they can be well integrated. The chapters are like the Panchayati Raj and the rural administration and the urban administration. They can be really easily clubbed together, and children already have a bit of knowledge about that. And fortunately, the children's parents also have, I mean, like, and some of them are mayors and some working for the municipal councillor as municipal councillor and representatives and all those things. And so it would be easier for me to club the, integrate in, all these three chapters. But unfortunately, we are undergoing a lockdown in the sense, like, in our school has shut down for about 15 days, 2 weeks because of the COVID. There was a case found. So I was just wondering how to do, how to go about it, how to do it. What I thought, like, you know, if the children were coming to the school, I would invite one or two of the people from the parents' community, and then it would be easier for us to go about. I want to know, like, you know, how well can I go about these three chapters club together, madam?
Could you suggest
or can you give me the idea? I'm very new to social science teaching, though I have the subject knowledge, but then I haven't taught social sciences yet.
So yes, ma'am. Yes. Just to understand better, you still are teaching online, right?
Yes.
You are. So I think having an online class and calling a guest speaker online is so much more easier. I cannot even tell you how. Like, we had guest speakers coming in who were sitting in the University of Michigan attending, like, online sessions and conducting, you know, sessions for our students. So, actually, use the online space to your advantage. Very often, getting a parent in during COVID and following all those protocols with vaccination and so on. Online is so much more easier to have a session, asking them to share screen if they want to add something that they want to ask. Students and putting their questions in chat, all of that, you know. So it is still possible to do it, getting guest speakers. And now you're not only limited to your parent body, but if they have contacts beyond your state, that is also, you know, something that you can use to your advantage. When it comes to this unit, this whole unit of local self-government is, it's so easy to bring in these chapters that you spoke about, Panchayat Raj and all of that. You know, just speaking about local self-government and looking at how it is different, a rural setup and an urban setup, in itself can have so much scope. You know, you can actually combine all these chapters together and it would be a great project for inquiry. And then doing a compare contrast between the, you know, the government system in a rural area with the panchayats and districts, and comparing it to your municipal corporations in an urban area, you know, will be like a great unit. I mean, like, if you ever do it, please do share it with us.
Surely. I'll just go about it, ma'am. Thank you so much. I felt so relaxed and I'm so happy that I got a solution for the problem. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Building on this idea itself, I mean, ma'am, would you like to share any idea of the activity that you would like to do in this unit? Any initial thoughts? They are okay to share. Maybe we can all build on it.
Is this for Yasmin?
This is for Yasmin only. Yeah, ma'am, any initial idea? We can all work together on building that activity.
Madam, actually, before closing, I had conducted an activity of election process, you know. Election of representatives starts right from the village level. So in that sense, the children had an activity in the class itself of election, the election process, you know, the polling or the casting of vote, how it goes about, how secretly they have to vote, and they should not let out whom they are voting. They elected their class representatives. So that was the activity conducted in the classrooms.
Yasmin, I just have one question. So, so when we are going about the entire unit, or even just like when you're planning back, especially for like three units together, I think one thing that's important at every stage for us to keep in mind is the goal and the objectives that we're working on. So just keeping that in mind, like you said, you started, I'm just wondering, have you started with building background knowledge and then gone into the class selection?
Yes, I had built background knowledge. I have told them, like, you know, how our government is democratic. From there it started. Like, you know, it is a democratic form of government. We are not monarchy. There are no kings and queens ruling our country. And now democracy. What do you mean by democracy? And what are the features of democracy? What happens in the democracy? Then who are the voters? And how do they vote? What is the process? In that till there we had finished, ma'am. And we have come to the Gram Sabha.
Yes. Oh, lovely. So you've given them an experience of actually, you know, understanding what a government is by having their own, say, elections in their school, in their classroom. I'm also wondering if you want to take this forward. So one, now that the elections that, you know, you have done in your classroom, is that, was that only for the activity or is that something that you wanted to take forward and
only for the activity. For the children to know what it is. I mean, what is the process it goes about.
All right. So that means, I think that's great that you started with that, giving them that activity and understanding what a government looks like and what a democracy or what are the processes in a democracy. Now with that, you will be breaking down to what is what was the municipal system in an urban area and a rural area looks like, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you, madam. Thank you.
To add to your thing, what I understand is also when you do the rural and the urban self-government, you will also come across functions, right? And you'll be able to identify problems that they face in the rural areas and how the government system there helps them, and so in the urban. I feel like even using things like role play and all work beautifully, like just giving students a setting, telling them whether they're playing the role of people settled in a rural area or urban, and giving them just a problem, you know, or telling them to identify a problem and act it out, and then as a classroom coming up with solutions, you know, will be great, rather than teaching them, okay, if this is a problem with water in a rural area, the panchayat solves it this way. They're kind of living it through like drama. Would be something that would be nice.
So I was thinking that perhaps we can even ask the students to do some research, online research, or finding out the issues that people are facing in rural areas. And that can be through scanning of news which are related to rural areas, what kind of problems they are facing and what kind of problems they are facing in urban areas. Yeah. So if the students are mostly from urban areas, they can research online for understanding the rural issues that might be there. And
there are mixed students in my class, madam. There are mixed students in my class.
That is even better.
That was an advantage. Yeah. Actually, they were discussing very nicely. The discussion session went on very well. They really brainstormed, like, you know, what they face, like, you know, particularly when their family members are from that background, in the sense, like, you know, they're representatives of that village, representatives of the municipal community. They shared, like, you know, what their mother did, what their father did, what kind of work, like shortage of, like, for example, the lamppost. There was a problem in the lamppost in the street, and how it was fixed up, which government took the role, like, you know, was it the state government or was it the municipal government, was it the rural government which took place, if it is a village, and in the rural, in the urban setup, like, you know, municipality, which problems and which work it took. So these things were they were discussing with each other, and it was a great session. Like, you know, they exchanged and they got a lot of knowledge about what happens in the rural setup and what happens in the urban setup.
Love that. Yasmin, I think that was great. One of the things, like Ms. Eva was sharing, that you can do is, and Ms. Ruchi was sharing, that you can continue building that background knowledge for them before they can independently maybe go into that role play or go into a situation where they are problem solving now. Let them look at, you know, solutions. Let them look at real life solutions of things that have happened. You can have your experts come in and talk. I would even suggest that while you're doing all of this, at every time, just you would also as a teacher want to monitor. So if you tell them to say Google and, you know, research something, it may be a very wide scope of information that they might receive. They might also pick up information, say, from Wikipedia or from sites that may not be giving them the right information. So for that, before we can give them that information, it's important that you also sort of scan through a little bit, have a template of what are the things that they need to find. So you know, like the what is the problem, or name three problems, describe the problem. So creating a template for yourself before you can share it with them, creating, just having an idea of what sort of information you want your students to bring back. Even if you feel like your students need more explicit support in identifying areas where they can find information from, then maybe that's also something that you can start thinking of before you move into these activities. Just something for you to sort of plan before you start, because you already have some amazing ideas. It's just about what are some things that you can keep in mind while you're executing them.
Surely, definitely I will do it. Thank you so much. Thank you.
I think we've lost Shalini.
Yeah. Gomti, another question that we had was about the student-teacher ratio.
Yes.
In a mainstream setup where you have 1:25, you know, as a ratio, as compared to what we have in our classroom right now, which was like about 6 students or 8 students.
Yeah.
So, you want to take that forward? Should I add something, and you add something?
Sure. Just before we move to that, is there anything else that we want to discuss on what we were discussing now, or should we directly? Hi, Shalini.
Yeah. I'm so sorry. I lost the connection. No, you can go ahead, Gomti, now. Yeah.
All right. No, we were just asking. So we thought of going to the next question. But before that, is there anything else that we want to discuss about just how we can integrate? You know, or if you guys want to share about how you all have
yeah, so we can talk with participants. Mayu, Rashmi, I think we are left with you. So do you want to share something with us, Gaurav? Anushya also is there with us. Do you want to say something like did you try something in social science studies, or any experience or any innovation which you think could be great to discuss with us? I think, okay, we can wait for them.
Hi. This is Mayur. Yeah. Sorry, I am not in the teaching field, but I just thought of that. I'm listening in this the overall session. Maybe the overall in any education concept, maybe I could say it. So I work in a project. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. It's okay, Mayur. Anushya was also there, I think. Anushya? Hello. You're unmute. You can share. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, ma'am. Like, I was taking 11th and 12th business studies, and like now only like I'm into the 6th standard civics. So that is really a very new thing, like to enter into a social studies. So don't know, like, it's like, how to say, so I'm very new to that subject. So I don't know how to handle with the subject main matter to the students, actually.
What's your plan, actually? Any initial plan which you would love to share, like what you are actually planning to do?
Okay. The main thing is I don't like social studies at all from my schooling. So this is really a challenging one. So I cannot say no. Okay, I thought of like, okay, let me adapt to this. Okay, I wanted to learn new subjects. So instead of going into the science stream, let me have it with the social studies itself. So I wanted to give some, I want to make my class innovative, actually. That is the main thing, because like, even I am very dry with the subject. So the subject is not dry. I am dry with the subject. So I want like a kind of an innovative ideas where I can make my students feel comfortable with my class.
I think, Anushya, just to add, one thing with social studies is it is a very relevant subject. A lot of the units in social studies, if we think about it, is relevant to our real life. However, okay, that's not something that we've learned. That's not how probably we've learned in school. We've learned it in a textbook, which is why we're not looking at how, we're not looking at those things that are relevant in real life, right? We're not looking at how this unit in social studies, say a gram panchayat unit or a panchayat unit, how is that relevant? But it is. We do have a gram panchayat in our country, and as citizens, we do. There is definitely something that we can do or we can be a part of, right? How do we do that? Something we've had the chance to. So I think when you are looking at your textbook and when you are looking at your sort of curriculum, now as an adult, we do know a little bit more about the world around us, so we can make those connections for ourselves. I think do that for yourself also.
Yes,
see what unit is relevant, okay. See how this is relevant. Say you have a, I mean, can I just understand what are some of the units or subjects that you have, or even chapters that you may have, or you're like, okay, what is this or you're struggling like... with?
Okay, fine. I have 6 standard, democratic government and levels of government.
Love
and key elements of democratic government. And now we are into, like, I'm at to start my Panchayat Raj. So before starting that, I got my UT3. So I'm okay. I just wanted to have all those things. I'm telling you, I don't like social studies. So, like, unfortunately, my senior heads, they asked me to go with social science. That is also only civics they have given me. Okay, that too for the 6th standard. Okay, this year they gave me 1 year of time. You have to go with the textbook. You have a practice with 6th standard. The next year, we will give you the 7th and 8th standard.
So Anusha, have you attended our previous session, which was in the same inclination, like the social science? So
no, ma'am, I got.
Yeah, so I think we would come to a Telegram group, or we would share through mail also the link of the YouTube. There, Zeva have shared her case studies where she had talked about democracy, right, Zeva? Yeah. So it was very interesting. Okay, at the same time, you could also find a lot of learning and insight from her case studies and whatever steps she has taken in designing the lesson plan. So that would be very helpful for you also to develop your interest in social science at the same time to help your students. So I think, right? I think Gopti and Zeva.
Yeah.
How will I get the link, ma'am?
We will share with you. You right now, we will share the feedback link with you, feedback form. There you can share your mail ID. Definitely, we will get in touch with you. Don't worry.
Try to draw parallels when you're looking at your textbook. No, try to draw parallels to what you're reading with what's happening in the country right now.
Okay.
Once you're personally able to do that and you're personally able to make that connection, and that's only when you will find value in the unit also, right? When you are seeing that there's some relevance of it in my real life as well. Otherwise, it's just in the textbook and you're like, what am I doing? Why am I teaching this unit? So yes. I think you for yourself do that. Draw parallels from whatever's in the textbook to your real life. Once that makes sense to you, then I feel like, and, you know, watching Zeba's video as well, once that makes sense to you, I feel like you will also be able to think about different ways that you would like to sort of represent the unit. You would want your children to then draw parallels in those ways also. So just once you can generalize what you're seeing in the textbook to your real life concept, I think then that will help.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah, thank you so much, ma'am.
No problem.
I just want to add one thing. Anushya, go back.
Yes,
and
ma'am.
Say you didn't like social studies in school. Very often.
Because?
Yes.
No, it's not because of the subject. It's because of my ma'am who took the subject. From 6th standard till 10th standard, I had the same ma'am who was teaching the subject. Like afternoon, after the lunch, I had my first period.
So I think.
So every time she starts with a history and ends with civics.
Fight for a morning class. You can start with that.
Yeah. now for my students, I ask for the morning class only because I told them, no.
Yeah. So, I think, thank you so much, Anusha, for sharing all your experience at the same time, your own, about your own connection with social science. So we could, now I request Gopti, if you have any, you would wanted to answer other feedback question and Zeva too. Yeah, please go ahead with that.
Sure. So like Zeba said, another question that came up was about the student-teacher ratio, right? Like you may have seen in the videos, in our school, the student-teacher ratio is extremely high. We have almost like almost two students. So it's a very small group also that we work with. The reason for our classroom and our school to have such a student-teacher ratio is that our students do need a lot of support in terms of language and also in terms of behaviors. So just like having that many teachers, having more than one teacher in every class allows us to give our students that sort of support. Also having a smaller group in our setting allows our students to learn through their peers better, learn from the teacher better, and also gives them spaces to be able to understand what's happening, the pace is right for them and all of that. So we do very consciously have such a small group in our class, in our school. Now, having said that, in your setting, one of the questions was around 1:25, right? What we feel like is pure learning is definitely something you want to push for. Students in your mainstream setting definitely, and in every setting, can learn from each other, right? You will have every student in your class will have a different strength, will have a different, you know, something else that they are good at, something else that they bring to the table. Leverage that. Leverage group work. That is something that we would always sort of talk about. Even in our videos, even in our lesson plans, if you would have seen, we do, you know, look, emphasize a lot on peer learning. We emphasize a lot on group work, on say the, you know, that 2 paisa protocol, all of that, where as a group, the students are all able to get their word in, and we are actively allowing every child to then learn. So putting them down into smaller groups, like I was sharing with Zeba as well today, how group work works in our school is we work very explicitly with our students in different settings and teach them what a group looks like, what the group work looks like, what are the roles in a group, what are some of the responsibilities when you're working in a group, what are some of the protocols in a group. In your setting, you may not need to go so deep into it. However, maybe before you start group work, you can always take them through, hey, this is the protocol, giving everyone a turn, you know, letting everyone share, having your roles. So your students, depending on their age group, may also be able to pick their own roles. If they don't know what the different roles in a group look like, maybe you can also spend a time or a visual talking about what are the 4 or 5 roles in a group. Say you have a speaker, you have a person who's taking notes, you have somebody who's doing the research, maybe 2 people doing the research. So you, depending on where your students are at, you can break down what the roles of a group look like and maybe give them the roles or let the students pick their roles. That again depends on your group. But always leverage. In fact, the fact that you have more students is great because you can leverage every student's like strengths and skills. Like Yasmin, you were sharing, right, about your group, your setting, where you have students who are so diverse. You have students from the who have family from the rural background. You have students whose families from urban background. So they bring so much different knowledge to the table. Leverage that. And in all our classes, we have students coming from such different spaces, having such unique experiences, and therefore having such unique skills and knowledge. Allowing them to work together, of course, in a structured setting, of course, with, you know, a set of rules, a set of expectations beforehand for the setting to, for the group work to be fruitful, is something that you have to sort of maybe keep in mind. You get a lot of group work templates online. You can get a lot of like visuals that you can use with your students. But it is very important before you start any new structure with your group. Say peer learning, say so you pair and share. So you have 2 students talking to each other and sharing with each other. Or you're doing a group work where you have the entire group working on one aspect of the project or one aspect of the content. Say you have like, you know, those paired readings where you have 2 students reading parts of the unit, you have 2 students reading another part of the textbook. You can leverage your, you know, the number that you have in as many ways as possible. However, it's important that you place expectations of what that work looks like, because assuming that my student knows how to work in a group may not be the most ideal situation, may not be the most fruitful. So in order to allow and ensure that your students do find success in working in groups or working with their peers, give them expectations, let them know what are the different roles, what are the different things that they need to do. Maybe just use a visual, use a simple like template to do so. And then start the group work. That's, I think, the only thing that we had from our end. Zeba, what do you think?
Yeah, like Gomti said, that completely makes sense. You know, having like a template to just help them understand, explicitly teach them how to work in a group would help. Additionally, when you have a large group, what you would do is, the inquiry process has 4 steps, right? That's goal, plan, do and check. What you would ideally do is do the goal bit as a whole class activity. So you'd build the background knowledge, you teach them the content, you would identify the problem as a goal. But in the plan, do and check, you would now probably divide those 25 kids into 5 groups of 5 kids each. and tell each group to identify with that problem what solution they want to implement. So that way you're not only implementing one solution, but the entire class has five different solutions now for the same problem, you know, and then they can implement that. So they can, now you can even identify more than one problem. So you have the scope of going, you know, not only in depth, but even in so much in breadth, right?
Yeah.
And having a large number really helps when it comes to like coming up with solution or presentations, peer feedback, group to group feedback also. And the final check stage also is valuable because you'll get so much survey and data from all students on what worked and what did not work.
Yeah.
I think both of you have really pointed out a most crucial point. Like even if you have the teacher and student ratio 1:20 or plus, inquiry process could be possible through group project or group work, and you could use any group template as shared by Gopi also. But you could also be even, but you have to be careful that it should be objective driven, because we also find it important that even the most creative teaching is always objective driven, right? So I request, is there anyone who wanted to share how they design the group work consciously with an objective? Anyone who wanted to speak or share with us about any group work which they did with the students and found it really helpful? Yeah, Jaya, you want to share something?
I didn't do it, but then like I work as a coordinator, so I normally help out my teachers in this. So in class 4, they have done it in social study as a group work. I think it's about states, various states. And if you see, if you go through the book, it's vast as well as there's not much into it. So with the teacher, we decided that we'll make smaller groups, and each group will be made in charge of a state. And they were first asked to make a mind map. Like they were put into a group and there was a group leader, and they were asked to have their meetings during the class period, because class 3 and class 4, this was basically done, and they are not big enough. They are still small only, and they need a lot of guidance. And then they were put into groups. So then they started with a mind map. They decided what all they are going to talk about, what all they are going to present. And teacher had to help out a little, like in assigning, okay, you find out about this, you find out about that. And children did get that. And amongst themselves, yes, they presented, and where it was states, they have even tried out with turbans, and they've tried out with bandhani. When it came to Rajasthan, they showed us, they did the activity in class. They bought some turmeric and water, and they tied the thread and all and showed. Right now I don't have images, but till yesterday we had a lot of images, because the children had tied up turbans and different types of turbans. Like in Punjab, they have this kind of turban. In Rajasthan, they have this kind of turban. And they were going around the school showing it to everyone. So yes, it was successful. But yes, in class 3 and 4, what we realized that they do need a lot of support from teachers. So that is there, but yes, we were able to do it. So that was done. But role has to be assigned by the teacher to each and everyone. Okay, this is what you will do, this is what you will do. So then they were able to do it.
I think, Jaya, just to add to what you're saying, definitely for the younger grades and the young, you know, students who are of a younger age, they do need a lot more support. In order to make the support more, like in order to still build on a little more independence, some of the things that really work for in school is we use a lot of visual, we use a lot of templates, and we try to generalize those visual and templates in different settings as well. So say I'm using a template for group work or a visual for group work, I can use that same visual in a math class when they're doing group work there, or in a when they have playtime and they're say working in a group. So reiterating that, especially for the younger grades, and you know, sort of generalizing that in different settings allows them to internalize it and then be able to use it independently as they have, you know, used it a few times, as they have practiced it a few times in those different settings. So I'll just say that's also something that you can, try.
I think that's something, surely this I will try, because that's the feedback I got back from teachers about it. Yeah. So I was like, okay, we'll try from class 3 and 4. So by the time they come to 5th and 6th, they'll be, you know, more accustomed to it and can handle it independently.
100%.
Yeah, so I've already put in a chat what we have already done about reuse, refuse and recycle. So this is how we took it to various levels, and we had people come and give us a talk. And in school, on each floor, we had a different color dustbin. And our class 5 and 6 children, they went to each class from class 1 to class 12 and they educated them. Okay, if it's a plastic, it goes here. If it's food, it goes here. And the aunties, the ayahs in school, we call them aunties. The aunties were also taught, okay, if this dustbin will go here, this dustbin will go here. So you have to collect it. And after 1 month, we had called a Raddiwala to school and they sold it and they made some money. It was not less money. They made around 400-500 rupees. And that they said, okay, we'll just keep it for something, you know, like, okay, we said, okay, we'll use it sometime else. So the next time we had a canteen, once in a year, we have a canteen where children will cook. And it's only like nothing, like without fire, they'll make sandwiches, juice, and they sell it. So for that, they said, okay, this money we'll use to buy the bread and all that. So their class, they were able to have that and they didn't have to borrow money from the admin office. They said, no. So the profit also. So it's like it's a big cycle. It goes round and round in that, you know, like one project leads to the other one. Okay, we got this, so we'll do it. So these are some things we are trying right now. To extent, yes, we are successful. Children are liking it. But if I take it with the CBSE school, because of this, we are doing a lot of flip classes because we ask them to read and come. And they present and the teacher just adds to it whatever is missing. So it's not really teacher driven. It's more our classes are more student driven classes where flip classes and collaboration does happen a lot. So we are able to finish our portions on time. So this year we are starting from class one, we are integrating. So today itself we had a meeting. The first chapter of English is going to lend to EVS, My Family. And the same thing we are asking the Hindi and Tamil and English teachers, like not the English, it will be Hindi and Tamil, that you should start with the same thing where they talk about themselves and they understand the same word in three languages. If it is my grandmother, so how do I say it in English? How do I say it in Hindi? And how do I say it in Tamil?
Absolutely.
Exact report, how it is going to work out, maybe next June if we meet, I'll be able to tell you how successful we were. But yes, we are planning the curriculum from now. That's December for next year, June. We've started the curriculum planning.
I think what you can keep in mind, and I loved in your what you've shared on chat, right? In the way you conducted the previous unit, I loved how you all also looked at every subject in terms of its assessment also. So in that one project, you were able to assess a language goal. You were able to assess a Hindi goal. So having that goal in mind, therefore, becomes so important for every unit. Your goal or objectives are what are integrated.
Yeah.
After that, from that integration of goal and objective and keeping those objectives and goals in mind, you can, you know, have a successful project and integrate successfully.
See, when the teacher starts her lesson plan, she is out. She is asked to give the objective. Yes. And how she's going to assess it. We do a backward planning as if like this is my goal. So how will I reach there? So what is my assessment? Assessment, we are not very strict about writing only like a question paper or something. It is oral. We have quizzes. We have puzzles. So we are quite open to any type of assessment. Only after class 9 do we get a bit serious about exam-based learning. And there also we are doing a lot of flip classes.
Lovely.
So that is where it is helping us.
Yeah, I think backward planning is key because if you want to like be able to address every objective, you know, successfully and not get diverted in the all the creative things that you want to do in class, backward planning definitely is. Yeah, so it's really nice to see your...
We start with backward only. It's not like everyone, the new teachers do get a bit surprised when they come to why this. We tell them, no, you go the other way around. What I want and how will I reach? Absolutely. Then your activity should be there.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for bringing this to light, Jaya. I think it's so, it's so relevant to also so much that everyone else in this group can take back. So thank you. Yeah. And it's wonderful how you all have integrated it with the assessments. I'm just so excited about that.
Yeah, even Yasmin is also quite impressed, Jaya. Thank you so much for sharing.
Thank you.
We can thing, Jaya. You can even have a recording or any other short of.
Yeah, last time after your thing, I've been telling my teachers that I would like to have recordings and I would be sharing. So we've just come back to school. So maybe by next time I will have some recordings too.
Sure, we will love to share with our other participants also.
Yeah.
So any other one more thing.
One more thing. See, like the teacher started, she had just a small portion in her thing about Braille. So she was like, how do I teach children? So I just had one suggestion. I said, you ask them all to close their eyes and read a paragraph you've written on the board. So I said, but don't write anything on the board. So the children all closed and she said, now all of you read. So she was like, the children were like, ma'am, we can't read. So she said, now you understand, how do those children read? So she was able to take forward, like, what is Braille and how did it go about and how it is important. And that was a part of her empathy where they can also understand how people without vision feel and this, that. Some things like, we are just trying out and it's nice to share with the group who will understand it.
I think if it's for the younger groups, even for the elder groups for that matter, I love how you're integrating like SE, so your empathy, building. So I feel like even read alouds are amazing. So especially with younger groups, having read alouds, you have a lot of really beautiful picture books or books with like very little language. Being, you know, having those read alouds, listen, you know, having them then share what they take away from that is very, very powerful. So I think that's also definitely something that you can explore.
Yeah, thank you so much, everyone. It was really interesting. At the same time, so much learning for each one of us from each other experiences, at the same time, each other ideas, you know. So thank you so much for joining with us today in this session. It was wonderful. And thank you, Zeba and Gumti, for your time and for your all your experiences and insights, which you have shared, both of you, from your school. And I think we are done with today's session. Any other comment or last word which you want to share with us? We would love to hear. So I think one more request which I have right now, can you all please switch on your video so that we can take a screenshot or a small memory for each one of us? Yeah, thank you so much. Now, I think I will be sharing a feedback link with everybody, and I would be also sharing the Telegram link so you can join our group. We will be continuously sharing our sessions update over there. At the same time, we invite participants to share their learning in the group too.